I can't remember much of fear. It was like, you just got to keep going. Just carry on. That's all you could do, really.
Barry Parker was only months from turning 2 years old when Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain announced Britain's entry in World War II on September 3rd, 1939. Growing up in Great Yarmouth, along the eastern coast of Great Britain, not much information was shared with small children about the war.
Obviously, the adults knew what was going on, and you didn't bother to explain these things to kids. In fact, during the war, I didn't know that all Germans weren't necessarily Nazis. I thought it was synonymous, which of course it wasn't.
War just seemed to be part of the normal life among the British people.
And of course, being young and not knowing anything else, for me, war was the natural state of things. That was all there had ever been.
Not knowing what was happening on the battlefield created a sense of calmness inside Barry and other children, since authority did not bother to educate them on the situation.
So the idea was, I suppose, everybody knows about the war. They didn't teach much British history after about 1800 anyway, the schools I went to.
This attitude of keep calm and carry on provided an optimistic morale throughout the war and helped the British people stay focused on their daily lives. As a child, many stories were passed on from older siblings to the younger ones, but Barry has one vivid memory that occurred very early during wartime that he insists is the truth.
Ah, now this is something which my brothers, my sisters particularly would dispute, but I maintain it's the truth. My earliest memory of the war was being pushed in a perambulator, on the main road of the town, which was perpendicular to the coast. So we were going towards the seafront. And when we got to the end of the road by the seafront, we found we couldn't go any further because there were barbed wire entanglements all across the end of the road and also on the beach. Because I didn't know at the time, but the beach had been mined against the German invasion. And those mines didn't go away until they were removed quite a number of years after the end of the war. So we couldn't play on the beach until I suppose I was about 7 or 8.
The British defense against Germany had a slow start until Winston Churchill succeeded Neville Chamberlain as Prime Minister only 8 months after Britain's declaration of war in May 1940. Churchill quickly took the reins of the situation and commanded his forces to join the French forces in hopes to hold back the German advance in Belgium.
He was a great national figure. I mean, on the newspapers, his speeches in Parliament were reported.
Unfortunately, this Allied defense quickly plundered after the German forces were able to entirely bypass them at the French Maginot Line. In response, the Royal Air Force, or RAF, headed to Dunkirk, located along the French coastline.
They did send an expeditionary force into France to try and combat the German invasion, but France was such a shambles that it didn't work. There weren't enough British forces there with enough armament to stop the Germans.
Allied troops continued to arrive in Dunkirk, France, but the German Luftwaffe bombers pounding these Allied defense positions brought the Allies to the unavoidable realization that this assignment no longer sees success and it's time to disperse. Operation Dynamo, the largest military evacuation in history, evacuated more than 338,000 soldiers. Following France's collapse, Adolf Hitler considered launching a cross-channel invasion of England, known as Operation Sea Lion. Hitler believed that bombing major English cities and industries would at least prepare for the invasion, and with any luck, it would bring Britain to its knees, making the need for an invasion unnecessary. The Battle of Britain was the first battle in history to be fought entirely in the air. It began on July 10, 1940, with a heavy German air raid.
The Germans needed to destroy the RAF so they could invade. And to invade, they would need 24 hours of air supremacy so they could get the ships across.
Unfortunately for the Germans, they lost more than twice the number of planes and the number of pilots the British lost. Hitler, being agitated with losing so many German planes, instructed his bombers to cease their attacks on RAF facilities and aircraft factories, and rallied to bomb civilian targets in a daylight mission. Commonly known as the Blitz, this mission took place in London, where more than 400 German bombers attacked the British capital. 56 of these bombers were downed by RAF fighters, a ground-based anti-aircraft fire. Hermann Göring, the German Luftwaffe chief, was stunned by these losses and decided that the daylight raids were too costly. So from September 16th forward, only nighttime air raids were executed. This portion of the Battle of Britain was made up of 57 continuous nights of incendiary and high explosive bombing that shattered the city of London.
And we can thank our friend Herr Hitler for that. He lost his cool and took to bombing civilian targets instead of concentrating on airfields and radar stations. I figured if they'd have continued their original onslaught of the RAF, that is the airfields and the radar, they could have won. But they didn't. They thought they would just get a quick end to the war by terrorizing civilians who weren't sufficiently terrorized.
In the end, the Blitz turned out to be unsuccessful. With Hitler retracting all German bombers from RAF facilities and factories, Britain was able to produce Spitfires and Hurricanes at an incredible rate. Operation Sea Lion, the invasion of Britain, would never carry through. Nearly all participants of World War II actively produced propaganda against enemies to promote their cause or to damage opponents. The propaganda publicized in Barrystown focused on encouraging people to join the war effort rather than to promote the anti-German spirit.
It didn't emphasize the negative too much. It was always trying to get people to do things, like careful what you say. A careless word in a pub could result in a ship being sunk. Things like that they exhorted us to do.
Mass media, like radio and newspapers, were considered the drive force publicizing propaganda. This enabled the government to control the public's morale and to fulfill their curiosity of the war's progress.
We heard radio broadcasts, which told us usually of advances, but didn't bother to tell us of reverses of the armed struggle.
The British Broadcasting Corporation, otherwise known as BBC, was a popular government-controlled radio broadcast that provided Europeans information on Nazi Germany. Seeking to counter the Nazi propaganda, BBC would provide accurate news and entertainment for the millions of people cautiously tuning into the broadcast.
The BBC had, at that time, were broadcasting on three different programs. One was called the Light Program, which was light music and light entertainment.
With me milk cart every morn I go upon me round. I've seen a window open wide when delivering the morning milk. I've seen a girl asleep inside when delivering the morning milk.
There was the Home Program, which was for sort of middle-aged curmudgeons. Nice thing about radio is you can do other things while you're listening to it. Mother would do the ironing, or whatever she domestic chores she was still stuck with. And there was the classical. It's called the Third Program. That was for the highbrow people who wanted to listen to symphonies and choral music and all good stuff.
Also, it was common for Prime Minister Winston Churchill to speak to the nation through BBC broadcasts. He was the most eloquent and committed spokesman of the time and sought relief for the disaster. He began to raise the collective war spirit of the nation with speeches and broadcasts of incomparable expression and life. He delivered his impactful Finest Hour speech to the House of Commons on June 18, 1940. In the speech, Churchill says if England can stand up to Hitler, All of Europe may be free, and the light of the world may come forward into
broad, sunlit uplands. But if we fail, then the whole world, including the United States, including all that we have known and cared for, will sink into the abyss of a new dark age, made more sinister and perhaps more protracted by the lights of perverted science. Let us, therefore, brace ourselves to our duties, and so bear ourselves that if the British Empire and its Commonwealth last for 1,000 years, men will still say, this was their finest hour.
The need for complete manpower control and the likelihood of rationing called for the government to pass the National Registration Act of 1939. A census of the population had not been recorded since 1931, so there were not sufficient records of the population to base important planning decisions on. As a result, identity cards were issued to every man, woman, and child.
I suppose it was to identify us from German spies.
Identification was necessary since families were often being separated, houses were being bombed out, and in case if someone was injured or killed. For administration purposes, cards were classified by color and a letter. Children like Barry, who were under 16 years old during the war, were issued temporary cards that were carried by their parents.
I think anybody could forge one of these so easily, but we had to carry them. Well, at least in my case, my parents had to carry it for me.
The British population had to carry these identity cards until 1952, when the National Registration Act was appealed.
The Tories, the Conservatives, were in government, and they decided to abolish national identity cards as an imposition on personal freedom. And this minister stood up and tore it up in front of Parliament. They like doing things like that, politicians, particularly if it doesn't cost any money.
In an attempt to weaken the enemy, at the start of the war, Germans attacked British food supply ships, putting the United Kingdom under serious food shortages. Rationing was an unwelcome yet necessary solution with the massive amount of manpower and production that went into the war effort.
Everybody was allotted a certain amount of rations, recorded in a ration card.
These ration books consisted of coupons created by shopkeepers that were signed to keep track of people's purchases of any sort.
Not everything was rationed, but vegetables weren't rationed. Things that were rationed were things like sugar, bacon, cheese, fats being butter, margarine, and cooking fat, and eggs and meat.
Besides fresh vegetables, fresh fruit, coffee, and poultry were among the food items not rationed. Clothing, furniture, and gasoline were some of the non-food items that were rationed, which helped create a flourishing black market that traded items such as gas coupons, eggs, nylon stockings, and cigarettes. Civilians were encouraged by the propaganda campaign Dig for Victory to grow their own fresh produce. This inspirational movement was a great success, turning gardens, parks, and sports pitches into a lush yield of crops.
Here is my ration book, my name on, and it's dated 1953, 1954, so I had one of these from when they instituted rationing until it was abolished. So it was still going in 1954. The country was still short of food for quite a number of years after the war. I had three sisters, two brothers, and they went girl, boy, girl, boy, girl, boy. And I was right on the end with nearly 10 years between me and the previous one, which caused some family upset. They thought the family was over. They didn't need any more. My elder sister was already a nurse. She was doing her training, become a registered fever nurse and a state registered nurse. I suppose that's similar to an RN here.
Training to become a state registered nurse in Britain during the 1940s was reduced from 3 to 2 years due to the United Kingdom's serious demand for nurses. Hospitals became very dependent on staffing students like Barry's sister Edith.
She was the brains in the family. She eventually wound up running 5 hospitals. My eldest brother, as I've mentioned, he drove, he didn't drive trains at that time, he was called a fireman. He was the stoker. He threw the coal onto the fire.
As a stoker, Barry's brother Harold had physically demanding labor ahead of him, fueling the steam engine of the Keatingham locomotive.
My next eldest sister worked at a munitions factory north of London, a place called Baldock, which I suppose is about 30 miles from London, making munitions with high explosive, a job she didn't really enjoy.
Collectively, the United Kingdom's munition factories were called Royal Ordnance Factories, or ROFs. Workers like Barry's sister Kathleen, who dealt with high explosives every day, endured the constant hazard of explosions inside the factories caused by machines overheating. Gordon, the second oldest brother among the 6 siblings, enlisted in the Navy, where he was sent to India.
He joined up when he was, I think, 17, and I was still quite small at that time. He thought, well, he'll probably be called up anyway, so he might as well get ahead of the game.
The Royal Navy, or RN, has always been the largest war-fighting force of Britain, and at the outbreak of World War II, the RN was the most powerful force in the Atlantic.
He was a lowly canteen assistant, but like a lot of the other guys in the Navy who were stationed there, he could afford his own servant, or boy as they called him. And he kept a pet mongoose. I don't know whether it was a pet or something to tackle the snakes and cobras, but yeah, the pet mongoose while he was there. He didn't bring it home.
India, known as the Jewel and the Crown, was vital in global warfare and a critical resource for Britain during the war because of its abundance in raw materials and conceivably large source of military manpower.
At that time, there was a Indian nationalist movement who were set on getting rid of the British.
India had been protesting for full independence since the early century, but the dispute amplified at the outbreak of World War II.
They took to a campaign at one time of blowing up British ships, and they blew up a number of them in the harbour at Bombay, now called Mumbai for some reason, Bombay, and set a number of them on fire. My brother, who was a good swimmer, dived in and went and got a motor launch and went and rescued people off of some of the burning ships. But they couldn't give him a medal because he was a non-combatant. He got an award called Oak Leaves, which are a small bronze badge with oak leaves on. And they also gave him a clock, rather a glorious clock, made of walnut, something produced in London by a company called Tompion, which his wife still has.
Since it was difficult for Gordon to keep in contact with his family at home through letters, he resorted to an alternative method.
He once sent us a load of chocolate, because confectionery was difficult to get hold of at that time. And it arrived, it had obviously been refrigerated. I don't know if you had experience of long-term refrigerated chocolate. It goes all rather strange. Nobody in the family liked it except me, so I got most of it.
Towards the end of the war, Gordon was able to return home.
I came home, very slim, very brown. I had some tropical diseases over there in India. I think he was glad to get out. I don't think he liked the social conditions in India very much, the amount of poverty, which was absolutely grinding. The next sister, that's the one closest to my age group, was still at school. And I was getting quite excited when somebody would come home and we'd see them again.
An average day for Barry at home was nothing out of the ordinary.
I suppose like a lot of kids' days, it would be up at probably about 8 o'clock. By this time, my father had already left for work. Most of my brothers and sisters weren't living at home at that time.
Being a small child, not old enough to attend school yet, Barry looked forward to his father coming home from work.
If father would come home again, we'd have what was called tea time. That would be sort of like a cross between dinner and lunch, sort of a light meal.
Family tea time was occasionally interrupted by the German air raids in Great Yarmouth, which were due to the large naval presence in its harbor. Several small ships, including minesweepers, motor gun boats, and motor torpedo boats, surrounded the dock.
Extraordinary vehicles, the motor torpedo boats and the motor gun boats. Small wooden vessels powered by two Rolls-Royce Merlin engines. They could do about 50 knots flat out. The guys who drove them were absolutely crazy, it seems.
These boats attracted the German attention towards Great Yarmouth, initiating various raids in the coastal town.
And when the Germans raided, of course, all these gunboats, torpedo boats, minesweepers were equipped with anti-aircraft guns. They reckon it was better than a firework display when all this lot in the harbor opened up, shooting at the German planes.
Since Germans began concentrating their bombing on Great Yarmouth, its citizens had to be transported away from the dangerous area.
We were soon what was called evacuated. That is, they took people out of the towns and put them into areas which they thought would be less subject to bombing. I think the idea is that, you know, civilians here will just be a nuisance anyway. So vital workers stayed where they were and their families got shipped out.
Barry's father was among those few who stayed in the town because of their occupation.
My father was a lorry driver. He worked for a company which made wooden boxes. So I suppose it was important that they had wooden boxes during the war.
Barry's brother Harold also stayed back in the town since working on the railways was considered a protected occupation.
He didn't like it much when my brother Gordon volunteered and went in the Navy because he felt he was the eldest, he should be going. But my mother told him not to be daft, he was okay where he was.
Nighttime air raids were not only achievable, but common for the Germans because brightly lit cities made easy targets. Even in rural areas, lights were spotted from the air.
Big shout was, put that light out. Because didn't want the bombers to have something to aim at. I mean, when you're a kid, you're stupid, and it never occurs to you that you might be killed.
To decrease vulnerability, cities and war zones established these strict blackout policies, which prohibited the use of street lighting and required citizens to cover all their windows with opaque blackout curtains or shades.
Well, you had to keep a blackout. Must have been some doozies of car accidents, because even cars weren't supposed to show lights. They had certain deflectors mounted on the front of the headlamps, which stopped the light from being reflected straight up. And of course, there was no street lighting. Didn't see street lights until after the war ended. So that was a novelty. So people had to find their way around with luck and torches. A torch is a flash lamp. But in England, we call them torches. Used to be an old song, which went something like, "When the lights go on again in London." It's a wartime song.
When the lights go on again, all over the world.
But people adapt, and you're a child, it happened to you. That's it, you know, sort of. That's normal, it's happening. You know, I was with the family all the time. It wasn't like these distressing old movies that sometimes you see of shots of children being stuffed onto trains and sent to the other end of England weeping as their mothers waved them goodbye and all that sort of stuff. It wasn't like that at all.
Like many countries, Great Britain developed many systems of civil defense. Organizations like the Air Raid Precautions, or ARP, and the Air Raid Warden Service formed to execute public air raid safety procedures. Also, along with constructing covered trenches and designing London's underground subway system, the government installed Anderson shelters, named after ARP leader John Anderson, for little to no charge in the gardens of London houses.
We had no less than 2 personal air raid shelters. There were public air raid shelters, which were brick structures built to hold a number of people. But we had an air raid shelter in our front yard, big enough to sleep about 4 people.
The foundation for an Anderson shelter was made up of a concrete base and iron hoops that correlated to make an arch buried half deep in the ground. It was then covered with at least 15 inches of sod. Many civilians were reluctant to go in the shelters at night because they occasionally flooded, and it was difficult to sleep in them. But Barry's family shelter had bunk beds, which provided slightly more comfort.
And inside the house, we had an armored bed, which was a structure built on the floor, and it was heavy, so it didn't go upstairs. It went in our parlor, if you like, the front room. And it consisted of 4 massive angle irons, vertical angle irons at each corner, on top of which was a steel plate, quite a thick steel plate was bolted on. And then around the sides there was heavy gauge steel mesh to stop stuff that would, like bricks, from rumbling in.
During air raid warnings, Barry's family would take cover in their Anderson shelter outside in their front yard. Barry's father never went in the family shelter because he was a fire watcher. All night he would monitor the fall of incendiary bombs from his designated area and report any buildings on fire. A siren sound warned civilians to take cover from the oncoming air raid. These warnings would sometimes occur every night, but only for short periods of time. Families had to spend the night in their shelters, but in the morning they were normally safe to return back into their homes.
Me and my mother would be sleeping in the air raid shelter. In the morning, father would bring us a cup of tea. I remember this particularly because it must have been one of the girls' tea sets, the China doll's tea set. He would bring my tea in the doll's teapot with a small cup. Sounds all rather silly now, but I remember it well. We were initially evacuated to a place called Peterborough.
Peterborough was located 98 miles from Barry's hometown. Its rural setting was less likely to be attacked than Barry's coastal home.
My sister, Sylvia, she was sent to a place called Newark in Nottinghamshire. And she stayed on a farm with another girl. When I say stayed, they were billeted. These people didn't have any choice who they got.
It was common for older children like Barry's sister Sylvia to be separated from their families during relocation.
The fact that she was living on this farm, they drank untreated milk. And when she was 21, she died of tuberculosis of the bowels. So I'll blame the war for that one as well.
Although Sylvia's evacuation site was 50 miles away from Barry and their mother's location, they only had to stay in these areas for a few months before returning home.
We went back home to Great Yarmouth. Maybe it was a lull in the bombing. And then we were re-evacuated to another place, nowhere near as far away, about 15 miles away, I suppose, to a village or a small country town called Loddon, L-O-D-D-O-N.
Being a small rural marketplace only 15 miles from Great Yarmouth, Loddon was a safe place to station citizens during an air raid.
We were billeted on the local postman, and he had a big house, so we were allotted certain rooms in there. My mother had to do her own separate cooking and stuff. I quite like being there, you know, just running around in the fields and what have you, helping to milk a cow occasionally across the road, but that milk was pasteurized.
Along with transferring Barry's families to his house, the local postman was also the local poacher.
And when he went around on his postal delivery rounds, he had a 410 shotgun, a folding one, in his post bag, and he'd knock off the odd pheasant when no one could see him. That's a tale that my father told me. I got no reason to misbelieve it. Yeah, so they kept various poultry, including geese. There was a great big gander. He must have been 3 foot high. And when I entered the gate at the front of the house, as all I could do, being about 3 or 4 at the time, to make it to the house before this gander got me. He was bigger than me. I remember on one occasion, well, it was the end of the gander, they'd wrung his neck and hung him up and cooked him. And we had a portion of it. It was very nice. I enjoyed eating him.
Returning home to Great Yarmouth a few months after his evacuation to Loddon, Barry witnessed the aftermath of the German raids on his town.
There were a lot of houses war damaged, some of them completely destroyed, what was called bombed out. Somebody who was homeless or had to move because the house was destroyed was described as a bombed out person.
Many years after the war, Barry received a local newspaper from his sister that contains a map of all the locations where the bombs fell in Great Yarmouth during the Blitz, as well as some of the bomb destruction. Mill Road in the district of Cobham, where Barry grew up, fortunately did not get completely demolished, but an area close to his home wasn't so lucky.
When I got back, I remember the next block of houses, these were terraced houses, was completely demolished by bombing, and the local church hall was gone.
This bomb damage didn't get replaced until roughly 10 years after the end of the war. Being a child, Barry utilized the bomb damage at home in a playful way.
That was my main playground. I enjoyed playing amongst the muck and the bricks when I was a small kid.
Among the bomb damage and debris around town, Barry remembers a mishap that his sister Kathleen underwent.
Our house had an outside toilet, and my sister Kathleen was happily sitting in there one day, singing to herself, and just as she came out, the nose cone of an anti-aircraft shell came straight through the roof, and it came from the Royal Ordnance Factory, Blackburn. So it was a British shell, which nearly got us. That's the only bit of ordnance I think I can remember.
In addition, with the United States entering the war, the Allies received a substantial gain against the Axis powers.
Once the USA came into the war, it was a foregone conclusion. The tremendous industrial might of the USA was game, set, and match.
Towards the end of the war, several British and American tanks passed through Great Yarmouth in preparation for D-Day.
I suppose they were always trying to fool the Germans as to where the landings would take place.
Also, many columns of troops marched through Barry's town.
We once had a large column of German prisoners come down our road. What they were doing down the road I lived on, I can't imagine. They were under guard, of course, and they were rested outside our house. So they all sat down on the pavements. Pavements are sidewalks, by the way, do a translation. So they sat down on the sidewalks to have a rest, and most of the ladies around would bring them out cups of tea.
The occurrence of D-Day was not announced to the British population until after it happened.
The idea was that you can't tell the population if that it's happening, if you want to keep it secret from the Germans. It actually did stimulate morale, having a war. The personal losses were tragic and huge all over Europe, and it should be avoided as far as possible. But usually it's the upper classes who don't suffer, and it's the lower classes that bears the brunt of the war.
During the war, not much of the general public traveled outside of their home country, which resulted in naivety and ignorance about the population outside of Britain.
I mean, we were taught that we were British, God's own people, and everybody else was rubbish.
Although the civilian population of Britain had previous knowledge about the nature of war, derived from their experience in World War I, the Germans failed to dishearten the British citizens.
The nation had a purpose. I think that did affect people, you know. We're going to win this thing.
The onset of war was characterized by problems of public morale, but the ascension of Churchill and the imminence of invasion quickly created a sense of togetherness among the public. Winston Churchill called the time of peril and suffering their finest hour. If Hitler had hoped to break the British war spirit by bombing London and other cities, he had badly misread the British public. If anything, the Blitz served to unite Britons even more and strengthen their determination to see the war through to total victory. On May 8, 1945, Germany officially surrendered to the Allies in Berlin. Within minutes of the announcement of Victory in Europe Day, or VE Day, tens of thousands of people gathered on the streets of central London and all over Allied cities to celebrate. Street parties were thrown and food, some of which was still rationed, was consumed.
We had a party. We had a street party. Yes, I remember. That was a good idea. You know what street parties are. They have them over here sometimes.
After 6 years of sorrow, pain, bravery, and strength, the battle was finally over. Many civilians rejoiced through spontaneous festivities, but others had a period of silent reflection. Nothing would be quite the same again. When I first met Barry, it was at the Camp Grant restaurant in Rockford. We sat at this table with one of my classmates, Rachel Felton, and her veteran or civilian, Shirley Fideli, and we got to know each other very well too. It was just so nice talking to him because I saw him on screen, obviously, for so long, and finally got to meet him. I was so excited. And I love his story. And then after we ate breakfast and it was time to wrap, things were wrapping up, we took a look in the museum part of the restaurant. They have different artifacts from the war, and it was neat because he would kind of point out little replicas of the planes that were in during the war and like rations. And I immediately realized that the man that I'm making this documentary for is so intelligent, as he's like a walking history book. So then I start with this story, Barry's story. It was so cool seeing how, even though he was just a very small child, he knows his history. He knows it so much that for many parts of my documentary, I didn't have to write a voiceover or use my voice because he explained it so well that I just put his voice in. It was so nice to hear his knowledge, and I just soak it up, and it was, oh my gosh, I just get so excited talking about Barry. After watching Barry, I had to come up with an overall theme for his interview. And after I sorted all the parts out, I thought, he seems very calm. And he almost had that keep calm and carry on attitude in his interview the whole time. Just being evacuated during the war and having to go on rations and having identity cards and having blackout regulations and air raid procedures. It was just how it was, just how life was. What I learned from listening to Barry's story was that the British side of the war was very determined, and their morale was incredible. The civilians back on the home front, they kept their spirits up. They didn't lose hope. They worked hard. They dug for victory. They just did what they needed to do to have victory. I mean, I'm just inspired by how heroic they were. Barry's story showed me a side of the war that not many high school students or any American student, I should say, knows about very much, because it's obviously a different country. It's a different country's perspective. I'm so passionate about giving Barry the best documentary that he could have about his life. Occasionally I would come up with questions or needs of clarification in the documentary, so Barry and I would always contact each other through email. It just helps bring a more personal aspect to my documentary for him. We don't see each other very often, and but I'm looking at his face every single day for at least an hour or two. And it's nice just to kind of stay in communication and have a more personal relationship with Barry. Being a part of VetDoc I'm speechless. I just... Being a part of VetDoc has been so meaningful towards me. I have become so passionate for the meaning of this class. It's just amazing hearing all the different stories about not just World War II, but veterans from the Korean War and from the Vietnam War. I'm just so much more educated on the wars themselves and what it was like to be in the wars. We have primary sources that we're learning history from, the war history on, and it's fascinating. I'm so appreciative for what these veterans have done for our country and for America. And just hearing the sacrifice and the bravery that these men and women have had, it's amazing. I honor veterans so much more. I seriously have a deep and honest appreciation for our nation's heroes, our greatest generation. They really are our greatest generation.